Hi, and welcome to another episode of Tom Kennedy Science. I'm, of course, your host, Dr. Tom Kennedy. Now, today is part two of my series on cell communication. Of course, the last one was on the cellular membranes and the extracellular matrix. Now, today we're going to talk about two things. One, how are adjacent cells held together? So we're going to talk about another class of proteins holding cells together, and then we're going to talk about paracrine signaling, or how do cells that are right next to each other talk to each other. You know, while we often focus on animals, right, we can't forget that plants and fungus are also multicellular organisms as well. So you have to have some way of holding these cells together. Now, of course, in plants, you know, you've got your cell membrane, the secondary cell wall, and then the primary cell wall. Yeah, I know, the secondary cell wall is in between the primary cell wall and the cell membrane. But outside of that is what's called the middle lamella. And there's this molecule in there called pectin. Have you ever played with jelly? It's all like sticky and squishy. That's similar to pectin, right? Pectin forms a glue that's holding these plant cells together in the middle lamella between the primary cell wall. But I'm going to focus mostly on animals. I mean, animals are awesome. I mean, plants are awesome too, but let's focus on animals. Now, first of all, you remember from last time, there's this class of proteins, and they're called integral membrane proteins. These proteins are permanent structures of the cell membrane, right? And a lot of them are called transmembrane proteins. In fact, most of them are transmembrane proteins. Then of the transmembrane proteins, there's a specific type called an integrin. And integrins, being transmembrane proteins, they go all the way through the membrane, and they attach the cytoskeleton to the extracellular matrix, like the collagen, the laminin, and the fibronectin, okay? And that creates a scaffolding for your cells in different tissues and organs. However, cells are also connected to each other adjacently. And this is really important. So think about cells. You want them not just connected in a scaffolding, but they're going to be connected to each other as well. And this is where we get the desmosomes and the tight junctions. And these are protein complexes. Now, what I mean by a protein complex is it's not just a single protein that forms these structures. It's multiple proteins that form these structures. And in the case of the junctions that I'm going to talk about first, they're actually kind of complicated. There's like 40 different proteins involved in a tight junction. So what exactly is a tight junction? And tight junctions form these watertight barriers. Now, you can probably think of where you need some watertight barriers, right? Your bladder, your intestines, your stomach, especially your stomach. So another thing that's interesting about these tight junctions is that they are dynamic. And even though there's about 40 different proteins involved with making tight junctions, the tight junctions are actually slightly different between your bladder or your intestines or your stomach. So think about your bladder. You don't want it to leak hardly any water at all, right? So they will form this very tight, watertight barrier. Same with your stomach. I mean, your stomach is a pretty rough place, right? I mean, it's got a really low pH because of hydrochloric acid, has all of these digestive enzymes in there, and you don't want that leaking out into your abdominal cavity. And in fact, if you ever get a really bad ulcer, an ulcer can cause damage to the mucous lining of your stomach, and then the acid and the enzymes can actually eat through your stomach, and you can leak stomach acid into your body and die from that. So it's pretty bad news. So you've got these tight junctions that will form these very watertight barriers. Now, here's something else about them. These structures are dynamic. Dynamic, yeah, that means they're flexible, right? So even though they're forming these really watertight barriers, okay, so let's imagine you're in your intestines. Well, the intestines have this function of they not only are digesting your food when you're breaking it down, but they also are involved with absorption. So whenever you eat a meal, you know where we're going with this, the tight junctions might actually relax a little bit, and by slightly relaxing, they can help the intestines absorb more of the nutrients and especially electrolytes from your food. So they're not just like rivets in an airplane that, man, you do not want those to ever be flexible or give way, right? I mean, they got to be set there all the time. The tight junctions adhering our cells together are actually dynamic and can respond and to the needs of the body as well. How cool is that? So like I said, these tight junctions are very common in your epithelial cells that line your body. Now, of course, the examples I just gave are the ones that are inside of your body, but they're also common on your outside of your body as well, which I just scraped my epithelial cells pretty bad, and I'm going to have to actually go to the urgent care today to get that taken care of. Yeah, I'm on a little bit of aspirin right now. Okay, another class of proteins are called the desmosomes. And desmosomes, they also are found in your epithelial cells as well. So your tight junctions, you know, what they are like is like stitching. You know, you stitch fabric together. Now, the other one is like the desmosomes. Now, desmosomes are like riveting in an airplane, or you take two pieces of metal and you rivet them together. These are the desmosomes. And like the tight junctions, desmosomes are also another integral membrane protein. They're permanently attached to the membrane, and they're also a transmembrane protein because they go all the way through the membrane, and they attach the cytoskeleton, especially keratin fibers, to adjacent cells. And the desmosomes, like these are like rivets in an airplane. And basically they are another type of integral transmembrane protein, right? They're permanently attached to the cell membrane. What they're doing is they're attaching the cytoskeleton, mainly keratin fibers, to the desmosome on the cell on the other side, right? So now you've got these keratin fibers, which are really, really strong, and you've got this desmosome coming together to hold them together. So the two cells, they go through the membranes to attach their cytoskeletons together. So that's a desmosome. So that means now we've got two different types of these proteins holding cells together, right? The tight junctions and the desmosomes, in addition to integrins that attach the cells to the extracellular matrix. So now that we know these cells are being held together, how do they talk to each other close by, right? How does one adjacent cells talk to another one? There's a couple different ways they can do this. And in animals, there's something called a gap junction. Now, what a gap junction does is it creates a tunnel. It's a large protein complex. Now, it's a little bit different than an ion channel, right? Because it's not so specific. It's like a calcium ion channel for facilitated diffusion. But there are basically these holes that go through one membrane, then you get a cell on the other side, and it's going through the next membrane as well. And of course, plants do this a little bit differently. They have what is called a plasmodesmata. Now, plasmodesmata is not a protein channel between these cells. Remember, plant cells are surrounded also by a cell wall. So the plant has to create a tunnel through the cell wall. And what they do is they literally connect their membranes through these holes. And those are called the plasmodesmata. And that allows for exchange of the cytoplasmic material between adjacent plant cells. And if you remember from a previous chapter on plants, especially the C4 plants, where the photosynthesis, where initial carbon fixation and the Calvin cycle are separated in space, because initial carbon fixation takes place in the mesophyll cell, and it fixes it into malate, right? And then malate has to get into the bundle sheath cells, where you can have the Calvin cycle, where you concentrate carbon dioxide in there. And basically the way it's doing that is the malate is passing through a plasmodesmata, releases a carbon dioxide, forms pyruvate, then the pyruvate moves back into the mesophyll cell through the plasmodesmata. Now, when these cells are communicating with each other like this, and they're just right next to each other, this is called paracrine signaling. This is two cells communicating to each other adjacently. Now, there's autocrine signaling as well, and that's just when one cell is sending out a signal, receiving its own signal and responding to it. But the paracrine signaling is cell, you know, just adjacent cells talking to each other. And in the next chapter, in the next video, we'll talk about endocrine signaling, cells talking to each other over long distance. Now, there are several reasons why adjacent cells need to talk to each other. And one of them is to release growth factors, important for wound repair as well. Now, as I just said, I just kind of scraped my leg up, so I scraped some skin cells away. What's going to happen is those cells adjacent to where the wound is are going to start sending out signals, growth factors. The cells adjacent to it will then receive it, and they will begin to grow and divide. And I'll eventually have a nice scar there in a couple of weeks. But that's a type of paracrine signaling, and that's, like I said, very important for wound repair. So anytime you've ever been damaged, those cells are talking to each other by sending out chemical signals and receiving them. And that's not the only reason why we need this. One is for growth and development. See my hand? my nice, I got a little finger here, I got a thumb over here. That pattern is caused by a class of proteins called a hedgehog and sonic hedgehog, which during our growth and development are very important for laying out our body plan. And this is a function of chemical signaling, how this differentiates into five fingers. And if you've got a problem with too much signal, you might have an extra digit like that. And if you don't have enough, you might have fewer digits than you're supposed to have. Important reason why also cell-cell communication is very important, especially in growth and development. And then, of course, one other example, and I'm not going to get into how a neuron actually functions in this class. I would teach that in like a plant and animal form and function where I actually do teach how neurons work. But neurons also do cell-cell communication, and they do that using a neurotransmitter. So quite simply, you've got a large neuron, and it's got this thing called an axon. Just think of this long shaft, and it sends an electrical signal down that shaft and causes the cell to release neurotransmitters at the end of the cell. And then the cell right adjacent to it will then receive those neurotransmitters and have a signal. And one of the most common ones we see all the time, muscle contraction. Our nervous system is doing long distance signaling, but at the muscle nerve interface, that is a form of cell-cell communication. And what's interesting here, have you ever heard of tetanus? Yeah, you should get a Tdap. I'm gonna go get one today probably. Well, a Tdap is for tetanus, and tetanus is caused by a bacterial infection. And this bacteria, what it does is it releases some type of chemical that prevents your neurotransmitters from stopping themselves. So they keep releasing the neurotransmitter. And what happens is it's called lockjaw because it causes all of your muscles to contract simultaneously. And it's horrible. I mean, it kills people. Luckily, we have vaccinations against that. And if you've ever heard of Botox, you know, people get Botox, and I never do that. Botox has the exact opposite effect of tetanus. Rather than keeping the neurons constantly firing and making all your muscles contract, Botox prevents the neurotransmitters from being released, and you just become flaccid and you can't do anything. Eventually stops your heart, so it's also pretty toxic as well. Okay, so that in a nutshell is a very, very brief introduction to paracrine signaling. And on our next episode, I'm going to talk about endocrine signaling. And I might have to just talk about how neurons work, because they're just fascinating how they send a message down the axon. It involves some of my favorite things, like our sodium potassium pumps and calcium channels and things like that. I don't know why I like transport so much. But at any rate, this has been another episode of Tom Kennedy Science. Until next time.